At the end of Joshua's life, after he finished all of his military campaigns to overtake the promised land, he died, of course, and his generation with him died. And Judges 2, verse 10 says that the next generation knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Now, this makes Joshua one of the greatest leaders in Israel's history and also one of the worst leaders in Israel's history. He won all the battles, but he lost the war. He victored over great skirmishes, but he lost in the grand scheme. And we all know factually that the last four generations in America have done something very similar. The last four generations have made America the most prosperous and powerful nation in the world, but have passed off the faith baton in miserably catastrophic manner. And as I watch the American church today, I'm not so sure that we have watched what they have done, and I'm not so sure we're saying to ourselves there's anything wrong with it. I believe, and I think the statistics are showing, that right now we are convincing ourselves and we are pursuing a path of being just as miserable and mediocre of missionaries to millennials as well. And I'm begging God to wake us up. When was the last time we considered how vomitably nauseating it is when a young person grows up in our churches and they emerge cold and lifeless and disinterested in the things of God? One of the great calamities happening in our churches today is that young people can tell that we are bored with the one we talk about. They know. When Moses went into the tent of meeting to be with God, of course, he had to emerge to go and decide the cases for Israel, but the text tells us that Aaron didn't have to go anywhere, and he just stayed. He just lingered because the presence of God was in that place. How often do we see our young people, when our gatherings are dispersing, that they just want to linger as everyone's exiting because the presence of God has so charged the atmosphere, like he has done in our midst today? David said it was better to spend a single day in the house of the Lord than 1,000 days anywhere else, because the glory of God had descended on that place. How many of our young people know the church is a place like that? Samuel grew up in the house of prayer with Eli, and he learned to hear and steward the revelations of God. The presence of God was in that place. And we are the New Testament church. And that means that the prophecy of Joel has been fulfilled. But will our young people see visions and prophesy? No, not until our old men and women dream dreams again. But I fear that so many generations have now come and gone with the reality of Christ being diminished and waning. We have become anesthetized to its sting. Our nerve endings have contracted spiritual leprosy. We have whole body parts getting lobbed off. We don't even wince. But how can this be? Whose job is it to declare the goodness and praises of God to the next generation? It is ours. And whose job is it to pass along a mantle of anointing to the next generation, that they would wear sackcloth and ashes, that they might be clothed in glory? It is ours. But this baton will not be passed by knowledge transfer alone. No amount of clever or well-organized scope and sequence to our curriculum alone will pass along the true faith. No amount of catechismal memorization alone will pass along the true faith. And if we are the best at knowledge transfer alone, we will produce but a cold, tidy, formal, lifeless religion that is disinteresting to a few highbrow intellectuals among us, but disinteresting to a perishing world around us. We need revival, church. We need awakening, church. And I fear that our sleep is so deep one might mistake us as dead. We need the spiritual defibrillators to descend upon apathy-filled hearts until we quit and stop settling for delaying death and we start succeeding at defeating death. We need awakening, church. We need a great revival in our midst. We need to awake. We are asleep. Men and women are perishing all around, and we're asleep. The name of Jesus is profaned all over the land of our country, and we are asleep. The glory of God is ascending back to heaven, and we sleep. The wet fingers of God are coming upon the wick of our lampstand, and still we sleep. Young men and women are more interested in humanism than theism, and we're asleep. The ship is taking water. We're drooling on the helm. We're snoring in the sanctuary. We need to wake up, church. We need a great awakening. No small turns of the dials will do. No incremental methodological improvements are going to save a perishing generation. We need revival. And what would that take? What would it take to see a great awakening in our churches? What would it take for God to revive us again? You know, it would take great preachers. If you're a preacher in the room, would you raise your hand? There's a lot of preachers in this room. I'm not talking about people who are great at preaching. I'm talking about preachers who are great for the Lord. It will take great preachers. Everything else can be right in your church, but your church will never see great awakening unless the mouthpiece is touched by the fire of God's altar. Great awakenings need great preachers. Every great awakening had great preachers. Where have all the mighty men and women of God gone? Where are all those preachers with defibrillators in hand, shocking the lifeless body back into vitality? Revivals were never started by committees. That's all I'm saying. God looks for the one. I don't know why, but that's what he does. He looks for the one for whom the walls of their soul are thick enough to carry the weighty glory of God. The one who is willing, the one who is ready, the one who no longer counts their life as dear unto themselves, nor their paycheck, nor their job, nor the affections or approval of men, but has counted it all as loss. Where are the Luthers, the Calvins, the Wesleys, the Whitefields, the Moody's? To the preachers in this room, let this sobering sentiment sink in. Revival in your church will first require revival in you. Only when the glory and fire of God fall upon and consume the preacher will the word of God go out with unstoppable force. The rivers of awakening flow out of the mouth of the preacher. If the mouthpiece has a dribble of a river within, you will have a dribble in your church. If the mouthpiece is a polluted stream, the church will be a polluted stream. But if the mouthpiece has a mighty rushing torrent within and a pure and untainted heart to channel it, then watch out, world. Watch out. Here comes God's power. We need a great awakening. And for that, we need great preachers. Not people who are great at preaching. Preachers who are great for God. This room is filled with men and women who are called by God. And you said, I want to be the one. The one that all of my heart and all of my life, nothing is dear unto me. Completely sold out for God, and the pains and the wounds of battle over time for some of you have caused you to choose to back into the corner of mediocrity. But God is calling you to be great for him. To see great awakening, we need great preachers. We also need great prayer. We need great prayer. We'll never have great preachers, of course, until we have great praying preachers, because the one who is little and prayer will be little in the pulpit. The closet is the heart's study. You know, those simple words, ask of me, they're the one condition that God places on the advance of his kingdom and of his cause. Ask of me, he says. Seek, says our Savior. Knock, Christ commands. The strongest preacher in God's kingdom is the strongest knocker. And when the Son of God rose before sunrise to get alone and to pray, when God incarnate himself spent the entire night praying, when the Apostle Paul says, first of all, then I urge that supplications, prayers, and intercessions be made, how then can we be so mediocre in our intercession? The great preachers we need for great awakening will not come without great prayer. Do you know that hardly a one of them throughout history prayed less than 2 hours a day? Martin Luther was asked what he had to do the next day. He said he was terribly busy tomorrow. In fact, so busy that his normal 2 hours of prayer would not do. He must pray 3 hours. He was going to be so busy that next day. Edward Payson, great soul winner in Portland, Maine, the first half of the 19th century, when asked the reason for so much kingdom success in his ministry, he wrote in his journal at the age of 26, quote, I was enabled to agonize in prayer for myself and the people, and to make intercession with unutterable groanings. It's said that the wooden floor next to his bed was worn by his knees from so much prevailing prayer. John Welch prayed, God, give me Scotland or take my life. He prayed. He devoted a third of every single day to prayer. His wife often woke up in the middle of the night to an empty bed, and she came in on him praying and overheard him saying, Lord, wilt thou not grant me Scotland? She watched as he sat in silence for a time and then heard him say, enough, Lord, enough. Another time she came in the middle of the night. He was in the other room and he was on the floor and he was weeping. She encouraged him to come back to bed. He said, oh woman, I have the souls of 3,000 to answer for and I know not many of them. Acts 6 verse 4 might just be the most despised verse of scripture by us pastors today. Acts 6, 4, the apostles said, we will appoint this responsibility to them and devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Most pastors today are devoted to doing the job of the shepherds and the job of the leaders and the job of the administrators, as well as the job of administrating the word, and have no time to labor long in the inner chamber with God. The text lists prayer before the ministry of the word. As it should, there can be no great preaching without great prayer. John Welch often refused to even walk up to the pulpit if he didn't feel that the presence of God was with him. It would become his time to teach, and he wouldn't walk up. Everyone would sit there in silence, and he had the elders come over to him and pray while everyone waited. And then finally he would go up, and it was said the divine assistance was unmistakable. Calvin Miller says, preaching in one sense merely discharges the firearm that God has loaded in the silent place. Mighty preachers are always mighty people of prayer. You cannot have one without the other. If we want to be like those in John 3:11 who actually testify to what we know and to what we have seen, unlike Nicodemus in that chapter who could only talk about what he learned, then we have to be in the Holy of Holies with God. You know, courage is one of the few constant traits that you will find in those God chose to use throughout the scriptures. Courage, courage for the battle, it is invaluable. You must have courage. But it will do you no good if your courage goes beyond your covering. Are you bold and are you willing? Good. Don't ever change that. But has your courage gone beyond your covering? If so, then I know Satan is socking you in the chin twice as often as he ought to be. It is good that you've become known in hell. It's not good, though, to be behind enemy lines in the spiritual realm by yourself. Preceding every revival throughout history, whenever the power of God struck indifference like a hurricane, there were a number of believers expectant, calling upon God in intercessory prayer. The great revival in the Scottish Islands began with two older women, Peggy and Christine Smith. One was 84, the other 82, and blind. And they were so burned with the spiritual state of their parish, specifically, that not one single youth attended. They couldn't stand that the pubs in town were filled with young people, but their church was empty with young people, so they decided to pray. They decided to start meeting twice a week. They started at 10 p.m., and they began to cry out to God until 3 or 4 a.m. This went on for a number of weeks. And then one of the two older ladies received a vision from God in prayer of their parish, their church, just bursting at the seams, couldn't even fit all the young people in it. She got so encouraged that God was beginning to move that she encouraged her pastor to begin to pray twice a week as well. And he called his office bearers together, and the seven of them began to pray twice a week. This went on from that point forward, six more weeks through the night, twice a week. And then one night they were kneeling in the barn and they were pleading this promise from Isaiah 44, where God says, "I will pour out water on him that is thirsty. Floods upon the dry ground." They said, "God, we know that you are a covenant-keeping God. You have promised that you will, and we come thirsty. This ground is dry." This moment, a young deacon in the church got up and read Psalm 24, which says, "Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who doesn't trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob." And at that moment, that young deacon, he lifted up his hands to the Lord and he said, "God, do I have clean hands?" It is reported by everyone present that at that moment, the conviction of God swept into that room. They were overwhelmed with conviction, a kind of conviction that only Jesus' presence himself could console, and repentance followed and revival came. Great awakenings need great prayer. They need great prayer. Great awakenings must also have great praise. A theme in what God's been saying to us so far in our gathering, I'd say. This is a testimony of Mary Peckham. She was a witness in the revival on Lewis Island. She said this about that great awakening. "When the people sang, oh, the shivers chased themselves up and down my spine. I never heard singing like this. The words rose to heaven in a power that could only be sensed but not described. The singing was fire. It went right through you." We need the worship of heaven to happen here. That's what we need. Worship, as we know, is simply the expression of the first commandment, to love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, and with all of our strength. And the love in worship, it can be expressed in a multitude of ways, both privately and publicly. But we also know the strength of our members' private worship by the strength of our members' public worship. Something that's been on my heart lately to speak to the churches is that there's a great injustice happening today that's completely blind to us. Now, it is a great injustice happening today that disciples aren't being made as Christ commanded. That is a great injustice. It's not the greatest injustice. It's also a great injustice today that the poor are not being fed. That is a great injustice. It's not the greatest injustice. It is a great injustice today that the lost are not being found. It's not the greatest injustice. See, we tend to think of injustice as the gap between what one needs and what one has. But that's not true. Injustice is the gap between what one deserves and what one has. And so let me tell you the greatest injustice happening today is the gap between the worship that God deserves and the worship that God gets. God doesn't need anything, but he deserves everything. And our churches today are bringing, as a sacrifice to him in praise these days, a lame and a spotted offering. The greatest injustice is when God gets an expression of love with some of our hearts, with some of our minds, with some of our hearts and with some of our souls. May it not be true. May God be worshiped all week long with expectation of him. Amen. Amen. And when we gather to worship in song, let's make sure, this is a word for the preachers, let's make sure that we never stop teaching the congregation that that part of our gathering is not for them, it is for him. It is not to please them, it is to please him. It is not for them to be ministered to, it is for God to be ministered to. Until singing is about God's worship alone, it will be catastrophic for our discipleship. And even though we have learned to laugh about it over time, let the sting of the reality that we are experiencing in our churches come back to us again. The ridiculousness that happens in the body of Christ, the bickering and complaining over musical style, this, that, not this, I don't like that. Worship is the very thing in our churches that is intended to fan the spirit into flame, and instead, because of the way our churches are responding, it is the thing that is asphyxiating the spirit into a flicker. And the Holy Spirit has no gallbladder to slough off such bile. We must cut it out ourselves if we want to see the glory of God descending on our gatherings. It is offensive to the Spirit of God. We must cut it out. We need great praise, and in all of this, for great awakening, we need great power. Great programs, great pragmatism, nor great plans will do what great power will do. You can have a very large church, but without true revival, it makes little impact on the morality of the community around. And who cares if Christianity is prevalent, if not powerful? The kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. Of power. God's love is unconditional. But his power follows purity. God's love is unconditional, but his revelation goes to the pure in heart. God's love is unconditional. But it is the prayers of the righteous person that become the slender nerve moving the muscle of omnipotence. Preachers, elders, pastors, we must be hungering and thirsting for righteousness if God can use us for his glory. God's spirit can flow freely through the one who wants to be used for God's glory, but not through the one who wants to use God for his own. We must rise every day, and we must do the work of crucifying ourselves to see resurrection power flow again. God's spirit cannot flow freely through the man or woman of self-importance. The envy allowed to harbor in the heart of pastors. The sideways undercutting of others, fueled by comparison and competition, all flowing out of a heart of self-centric pride, of selfish ambition, of sad insecurity. This must be dealt violently with on the cross. God's power cannot flow through that. The Spirit of God will not flow through the arrogant man or woman. Are you superior in your theology? Are you superior in your methodology? Are you superior in your ecclesiology? We must throw off the lead apron of arrogance and allow the x-rays of God to pass through us once again. God will not, he cannot, he refuses to pour himself into any vessel other than an empty one. And I think we all have been to enough conferences that we know us pastors, we can be as arrogant and puffed up and self-righteous as any. And we wonder why we run so hard and take so little ground. God himself is resisting us. He resists the pride, the proud. I will say to you that I am praying for a great awakening in our denomination. And I know it starts in the hearts that are in this room. And I stand in front of you confessing that I myself, I have been settling for polluted definitions of purity in my life. I will be the first to confess to you that I have sinned in taking myself too seriously and God too lightly. I have tried to use God in my life to make myself significant. I've allowed envy and pride to reside in me. And I confess those things to you. And I'm making a vow to my brothers and sisters to repent of these things. To empty myself before God every day. To refuse to proceed into a day where I have not become hungry and thirsty for the things of the kingdom. To re-crucify myself to the Lord every day. I wish that I could do it once and it would last for 2 days. It never does. Every day I have to crucify the passions of my flesh. And I make a vow to be a man of much prayer. And much praise. I wonder if, before we close today, we could just have a moment of prayer, just us and God. And so I invite you to enter into a time of conversation, of prayer with your Lord.